Good morning, everyone. So, I'm very sorry that I changed the title of the slide and then content last minute. But however, this will be a good one to be delivered in this opportunity. So basically, I would like to share several experiences related with how we deal with this kind of problematic paleosol zone in geothermal well. And I would like to deliver several experiences and cases in Indonesia. And we use our product called Perflex in order for us to be able to help our client to successfully drill through safely through this problematic zone. Okay, the outlines of my presentation will be, we're going to see at the first slide, the case study, how we develop this kind of product called Perflex, and how the Perflex product can also help our client to safely drill through this problematic zone. And then we're gonna see the introduction a bit about how this kind of drilling risk should be mitigated, and what kind of problems related with this kind of drilling risk. And then we're gonna see the unstable formation itself in volcanic hydrothermal system, which is probably related with several system here in Taiwan. And then we're gonna see the analog fields and the mitigation plan. So yeah, as probably we already heard from the last session yesterday, the risking is important in geothermal project. And as part of the de-risking itself, we are not only talking about the de-risking about the geothermal resource itself, but we talk about the de-risking of the operation itself. When we talk about the de-risking in geothermal drilling, then we need to be able to really anticipate any materials, the unstable one, when we beneath the subsurface, beneath the ground. So we need to identify in advance in order for us to be able to prepare the mitigation plan. In the exploration stage, most of the data actually collected from surface. So we haven't really drilled the well yet. So most of the approach in the past, we just try to anticipate and use the analog fields in order for us to be able to identify what we are going to deal with when we drill a well. And once we drill the exploration well, for sure we already got the data. We got the rock cuttings, we got the formation evaluation. So from there, now we can understand better about what we are going to deal with when we drill a well there. So that's why once we got the exploration wells, it's very critical for us to be able to interpret the data, not just collect the data, and make sure when we collect the data is a high quality one, not a bad one, because garbage in, garbage out. So we need to make sure the data quality that we collect is very high quality. And now we have been able to understand the reservoir condition better. And in this case, the challenges at the time is our client drilled several wells, close to 50 wells already, and they are in the effort to really catch up the commitment to deliver certain megawatts. And then from out of these 50 wells they already drilled, 50% of the wells actually end up with SAPAT incidents. And they actually invite us to really help them to evaluate what kind of risks and problems that they already faced actually in the past drilling activities that result to this 50% stop-up incident, which it will impact to the project economic of their asset. And at the time, we tried to collect all the samples from all the wells. So we just found out that they actually encountered this kind of formation called paleosol, as you see here in the picture, the red color. Many people call it red clay. Several people probably call it smectite rich formation. Other people call it paleosol. So this kind of terminology. But actually, all of these three terminologies actually relate and refer to this kind of materials, the red one. And once we identified, now we see the correlation. Whenever the wells, the stockpot one, encounter this formation, that will be the depth where they also experience stockpile. So once we see this kind of consistency, now it's about to collect the samples from the cuttings. We bring it to the labs, and we conducted several tests, which we are going to see later in the lab. and we also use our chemicals to see how the materials will respond to each specific chemicals. And we are going to select the chemicals that will give the optimum performance. And by having that kind of test, we come up with this kind of formulation called Perflex. And we use it, provide it to our client, and the result showing that they are able to avoid the stuck pipe, and they could save around $1 million per well, because they successfully anticipate all the stuck pipe incidents. So now we see how the journey, the experience in the risking. When we talk about the risking, we not talk about the risking the resource, but we talk also the risking of the drilling activity itself. So why is it important? So as an introduction, as you can see over here, if you see the perfect well, for example, based on their fields indicated by this blue color, and if they perform well, then they probably got incentive from their company, and then that's how the company, the geothermal company, actually encourages the drilling team to perform well when they drill well. So as we can see over here, the plan, let's say for example here, they plan to drill 27 days, and then actually they drill, for example, 5 days. So additional 5 days because of stock pipe. So you can see with the additional 5 days, how it will impact to the project economy. So some numbers from Indonesia, I took this one from paper published by Purba et al. In 2021. So there are two things that I need to highlight here. The first one is most of the stock pipe actually in Indonesia associate with this kind of loss zone, where in the loss zone, we're gonna say it as a blind drilling, so no cutting actually going up to the surface. So when we penetrate into the interval depth, so we don't know what we are going to deal with. So most of the time, this kind of stuck pipe occurs during losses, based on the data. And as we can see over here, the stuck pipe also contribute to the NPT, non-productive time. And unlike in the oil and gas, the geothermal reservoir is underbalanced. So that's why drilling fluid and mud shall be utilized accordingly to deal with this kind of condition. And reaction of this drilling fluid with the formation should also be anticipated, because most of the formation in geothermal, usually they can't react with any fluid that we use during drilling. And about the physical, as we can see over here, unlike in oil and gas, the rock is relatively incompetent, while in the geothermal, since we deal mostly with igneous rock and metamorphic rocks, most of the rock actually are competent enough. So when we say about the competency of the rocks, so that's why geomechanics is not really applicable in volcanic hydrothermal system, but it's probably applicable to the other system. But depending on the type of the rock that we are going to deal with. But if we deal with this metamorphic rock and igneous rock, mostly it is competent. So that's why if we experience any stuck pipe related with unstable formation, likely it's not because of the formation, but it's because of the clay. Talk about the clay. So there is a chemical reaction. When a certain formation gets exposed to the surface, there will be oxidation process because of the oxygen get reacted with all these kind of layers when it gets to the get exposed to the surface. But when it got buried, then this kind of oxygenated layer now become a layer that is called as a dehydrated one, and this dehydrated oxygenated layer can easily get reacted when we use any drilling fluid, and this kind of reaction will result to a swelling effect. So a bit about the hydrothermal minerals. So when we talk about clay, the reactive materials in geothermal, so we talk about clay. And when we talk about clay, clay is actually a footprint of the reaction between geothermal fluid and formation. When the geothermal fluid is flowing up to the surface, the geothermal fluid will pass through the formation, and the reaction between the fluid, the geothermal fluid and the reformation will create this kind of hydrothermal play depending on the temperature of the geothermal fluid that passed through the formation. So in this case, I would like to highlight these three materials: smectite, illite, and kaolinite. So smectite is actually the material that we need to anticipate in the reservoir section. If this smectite clay present in the reservoir, then this is the material that will cause a lot of problem to the drilling activity, because this material can get easily swelling when it get exposed to drilling fluid. And in reservoir section, the most of the clay actually dominated by illite, not smectite. So the illite one is actually non-swelling one. And for us, aside from this kind of drilling risk, when we drill a geothermal well, we usually use these two minerals to indicate whether we already penetrate into the reservoir section or not. So the geophysics also can also help and contribute to the identification of the smectite. During exploration stage, the low resistivity anomaly will associate with smectite, and the non-low resistivity, the high one, will relate with the illite. So that's how we identify the and separate between clay cap and geothermal reservoir. So that's why it's very critical for us to be able to identify the smectite clay in advance, whether they present in the reservoir or not, or at what depth they are going to be encountered. And unlike in the kaolinite, if the geothermal fluid is acidic, likely we are going to have this kaolinite clay. And in the case of kaolinite, it is not swelling. There is no swelling effect if this kaolinite material get exposed to drilling fluid. However, it easily could get dispersed if our drill bit or BHA penetrate in through it. So, yes, I said this before, this kind of unstable formation called in three different terminologies in Indonesia. Several people call it paleosol, several people call it smectite rich material, several people call it red clay. The reason why they call red clay because the color is easily identified by the reddish color. So let's say time zero, we haven't drilled the well yet. Let's say we have formation A, B, and then there is a paleosol here layer, very thin layer. And when we drill well, we pass through it and we haven't identified yet, because it's, for example, this is an exploration well, then when we don't anticipate it, then this kind of material will get easily swell. When it gets swell, then the material will fall down, all the materials, and create an excessive cuttings within the wellbore. And when this excessive cutting is not anticipated, then it will just go over here, especially if we cut TLC, total losses. Then instead of the cutting going up to the surface, then the excessive cutting now going to the fracture. Now it really depends how big the fracture is. We know that the fracture is not that big to accommodate the size of the cutting, because when we talk about fracture is tiny, right? So the fracture cannot really accommodate the size of the cutting. Then the some excess cutting here will just stay in the wellbore. This will be the moment when we get stuck pipe and pack off. So let's say we abandon the original hole section. We drill the sidetrack one, for example, like 25 meters away. Then when we penetrate into it, this formation already disturbed by the original hole. And because of this kind of situation, then the when we just drill out the top layer of the formation, then we likely to experience this kind of stuck pipe already. Unlike the original hole section, we need to drill past through it to experience stuck pipe, but in the sidetrack session, usually we already got stuck pipe when we just drill through the top layer. And as I mentioned before, the characteristic of this material is actually impermeable, dehydrated, fine-grained tuffs. So several oil and gas people will call it like shale, but it's actually not shale, but it's actually clay with fine-grained tuffs, and we call it paleosol. And when we introduce this material with drilling fluid, as I mentioned before, it becomes physically unstable, and it can create this kind of unstable formation and provide an excess cutting into the wellbore. So the analog fields, I will take the paper from Rich Gunderson from Sarula Geothermal Field. So UNOCAL in 1990s actually already experienced this kind of problems in their field in Sarula. When they drilled the exploration well in Sarula, they already identified this kind of material. So they collected the rock cuttings and analyzed the rock cuttings right away with the methylene blue analysis. So the well site geologists actually analyzed that one and produced this red profile over here. So the red profile actually indicate the methylene blue. So in the smectite layer, the methylene blue will be high, the value, while in the reservoir section, when we encounter E-lite, the value of the methylene blue will be low. And usually when we already see this kind of low methylene blue, this is the reservoir section. That's why when we already see this one, we're gonna set the fluorescent casing suit, and then we set the perforated liner. This is what we call as a reservoir section. And in this section, we likely to encounter losses because we encounter fracture. And the problem is, during this section, if you notice, there's a spike here. The spike of the methylene blue indicate there is smectite layer. When we encounter this smectite layer within the reservoir section, where we have losses as well as already captured in the previous cartoon, so we can see that now it's really going to be very problematic and very challenging for us to enable all these excess cutting to be brought up to the surface. So instead, it's just like accumulated within the wellbore and create this stuck pipe. And the same thing they also experience in the other wells. So as you can see that the paleozoic smectite bearing actually thicker as compared to the previous well that they did. So you can see that you can actually read it more details in this paper that written by Gunderson in 2000. And talking about salar geothermal field, same thing. So they also drill well. So actually most of the wells here in Salak executed by UNOCAL as well. So it was published by Gunderson as well in 2000. So as you can see over here, the chart, the black line over here is actually well trajectory and as well as the methylene blue. The thicker the line, the higher the methylene blue. So we can see that in the clay cap section, they encounter this kind of thick methylene blue because they know that this is a clay cap. When they penetrate into the reservoir section, as indicated by, for example, this temperature contour map. So usually the temperature in the geothermal will, in Indonesia, we're gonna encounter reservoir section at temperature higher than 200 degrees Celsius. So when we penetrate into depth interval deeper than this section, where we have temperature higher than 200, you can see that in some wells, they also encounter this kind of, we call it high methylene blue, which is associated with this smectite layer. And even in this well, in Namora Ilangit, in Sarula, they also encounter the smectite layer at the deeper part of the well, so near the TD. So we can imagine how challenging drilling a geothermal well if we don't anticipate this kind of problem and if you don't identify this problem in advance. So this is also from a published paper from Putra in 2022. So he published this one, the experience from Sorik Marapi geothermal field. So as you can see over here, the purple color over here indicate the methylene blue, the value. And you can see that at the deeper section of the well, they also encounter this high smectite or high methylene blue layer, and it is in the reservoir section where losses also already encountered, which now it also increased the challenging situation in drilling this well. So they actually collect all the samples and bring to the labs, and they conduct several tests at a time. It was also like a joint effort between this company who operate this field with Baker Hughes. So we received samples from them and conduct erosion tests, swelling tests, and also accretion tests in the lab. And we received samples from many wells as well. And each samples we just also mixed it with several chemicals to see how the samples react with any chemicals that we are going to use to mitigate this kind of stuck pipe problem. So you can see that we start with zero, nothing. We don't inject any chemical. So you can see how bad the reaction of the materials with this kind of introduction of the drilling fluid. And when we slowly increase the ratio of KCl and also perflex, we can also see several results on each test that we have here: erosion, swelling, and accretion. And we just found out that the optimum result shown here by the test number 11. So we can see that the accretion can be reduced to 0.23%, and then we also get the swelling rate result, the most optimum one as compared to the other tests, and then as well as the erosion test. Now we conclude that with this kind of formula, 8% KCl and 4% perflex, then we save. Okay, sorry. Okay, because time is up. No, okay, this is the last slide. So how to drill safely through paleosol. So as I mentioned before, during exploration, we don't know yet what we are going to deal with beneath the ground. However, we can try to improve our understanding by using the analog field. For example, if the field is located in Tatun, likely any field nearby Tatun will have the same characteristic. So any lesson from the other wells that already drilled in Tatun can be used as a reference. And then once we drill our well in our specific resource, then we can understand better because we collect samples. And but it's also important during drilling, we analyze methylene blue, because methylene blue will help us to identify which samples that associate with smectite, which one associate with elite. So we need to anticipate the presence of smectite in the reservoir section and in deeper section, and collect that one. And then in the same time, we also need to conduct any lab test. If we already experienced this stuck pipe, collect the samples from the rock cuttings and then bring it to the lab and conduct the test, so we can actually find out and define the right recipe to anticipate this kind of swelling clay. And lastly, from Baker Hughes, we promote our product called Perflex that already proven to help to avoid the stuck pipe. Okay, I think that will be all from me. Thank you very much.